Şimdi geçen derslerde Verification, Validation of Simulation Models'a başlamıştık. Kısa bir özet yapacağım. Sonra kaldığımız yerden devam edeceğim. Verify, Validation. Simülasyonda çok önemli iki aşama. Bunları geçmeden modelinizi analiz için kullanamıyorsunuz. Tamam mı? Verification, Validation'dan sonra ancak ikinci kısım olan şurada gördüğünüz analize geçebiliyorsunuz. Şurada gördüğünüz. Bu ikincisi şu kutucuk. Output analysis. Modelinizi kullanmak, karar vermek kısmı. Onu yapmadan önce bir modelinizi doğru mu doğrulamanız lazım. Geçerlilik ve doğrulama Türkçesi bunların. Verification, validation farkı neydi? Kısaca hızlıca size açıklayayım, hatırlatayım. Arkadaşlar verification ya doğru kodu, arenayı doğru kodladınız mı? Arenadaki şeyleriniz doğru mu? Şimdi bakın. Gerçek yaşam kompleks bir model değil mi? Gerçek yaşam sistemleri kompleks modeller. Size geçen derste de anlatmıştım. Değil mi? Demiştik ki gerçek yaşam çok kompleks bir durum. Gerçek yaşam. Biz bunu conceptual modelle biraz varsayımlarla basitleştiriyoruz. Modellenebilecek hale getiriyoruz arenada. Ondan sonra bu conceptual modeliniz, bu gerçek sistem, gerçek sistem. Bu da arena modeliniz, arena kodunuz ya da neyle kodladıysanız. Bir sürü bu arada simülasyon dili var. Hepsi arenaya benzer çalışıyor. Extend var. Böyle değişik değişik çıkıyor. Arena en yaygınlarından. Şimdi arenada onu kodladınız. Conceptual modeliniz. Evet şimdi verification. Arenayı şu step arkadaşlar. Verify de etmek demek sisteminizi. Arena kodunuz doğru mu? Kafanızdaki conceptual modeli doğru yansıtabildiniz mi arenada? Yani istediğiniz gibi çalışıyor mu? Tamam mı? Conceptual modelde olan anlatılan şeyleri arenada doğru kodladın mı sistemi? Verification. Bu verification. Yani kodlama hatası yaptın mı, bir yerde bir şey unuttun mu, bir yerde saat mi kaldı, dakika vardı, saat mi kaldı? Bu verification. Tamam mı? Verify ettikten sonra, evet benim arena modelim düzgün, kafamdaki conceptual modeli doğru kodlamışım ben dedikten sonra anca ikinci step'e geçebiliyorsunuz. Bakın zaten verify değilse tekrar bak, nerede hatam var, bulman lazım. Sonra ikinci aşamada validation'da ise valid modelin var mısa sorduğun soru şu. Acaba benim esam hani siz kompleks sistemi basitleştirdiniz ya küçük bir dikdörtgen şu aşama var ya şu kompleks model gerçek yaşam sistemini basitleştirdiniz ama belki öyle o kadar çok basitleştirdiniz ki gerçek yaşamı artık reprezent etmiyor yani conceptual modeliniz yanlış baştan yanlış varsayımlarınız var validation'da dolayısıyla bu step elinizdeki conceptual modeli gerçek sistemle, gerçek datayla karşılaştırmak da validation oluyor. Tamam mı? Validation'da conceptual model gerçek sistemle karşılaştırılıyor. Orada bir hata yaptım. Eğer varsa hata, validation'ı geçemezseniz ta başa dönmeniz lazım. Ta başa dönüp conceptual modeli düzeltmeniz lazım. Nerede varsayımda nerede hatam var? Çok mu fazla varsayım yaptım? Çok mu az varsayımım var? Bunu düzeltmeniz lazım. Ondan sonra tekrar verification. Anlaşıldı mı? Validation kalırsa en başa geri döneceğiz. Demiştik. Sonra verification için neler yapabilirsiniz? Bunlardan konuştuk. Tekrar etmeyeceğim. Aynı şekilde validation için neler yapılabilir? Bunlara başlamıştık validation'da. Yüksek görünüm geçerli. Yani şu conceptual modeliniz gerçeğe benzesin. Varsayımlarınız mantıklı olsun. Gibi şeyler, öneriler vardı burada A şıkkında. Gene varsayımlarınızı, B şıkkında varsayımlarınızı valide edin. Ve görünürde gerçeğe benzesin. Yani bunu okuyan bir kişi gerçek sisteme evet benziyor desin. Ve en çok bu C şıkkı. Bu C şıkkında burada biz analiz yapacağız. Input, output transformation'larını valide edeceğiz. Yani bu gerçek sisteme çıkan input, output'a bakacağız gerçek sistemde. Bizim simülasyona çıkan output'a bakacağız. Ve bunları karşılaştıracağız. Testler yapacağız. Ve bu testler sonucunda diyeceğiz ki evet bu testler sonucunda bu iki sistem benzer sonuçlar üretiyor ya da çok farklı sonuçlar üretiyor. O yüzden valid değildir ya da validtir diyeceğiz. Şu iki output'a bakarak validation için. Şimdi bir tane example'a başlamıştık geçen hafta. Ve bu example'da şimdi karşılaştırabileceğiniz şeyleri şurada göstereyim size. Modelin çıktıları. Nelerdir çıktılar? Yani bir bekleme süresi, kuyruk uzunluğu nedir maksimum? Ortalama bekleme süresi, utilizasyon. Ne yani Y1 modelden gelen Y1 var, bir de sistemden gelen Y1 var. Sistemden gelen Y1 ne demek? Gidiyorsunuz gerçek data topluyorsunuz ya sistemden. O gerçek datanın sonuçlarına göre bir Y1 var. Bir de modelinizden gelen Y1 var. Bu ikisini karşılaştıracağız. Yani tamam mı? Bu amacımız bu. Numerik kısımda amacımız bu. Ve buradaki örneğimizde de bizim ele alacağımız performans measure'ı Y2 idi. Geçen derste de bunu da söyledik. Yani Y2 burada ortalama bekleme süresi. Tamam, iki tane. Şimdi sisteme bakıyorlar. Sistemde ortalama beklemelere bakıyorlar. Gerçek sistemde. 4,3 dakika çıkıyor. 4,3 dakika biz buna true mean diyeceğiz. Yani sistemin mu zero diyeceğiz. Gerçek beklemesi 4,3. Bizim buna yakın bir değerler almamız beklenir. Değil mi? Şu tahtayı temizleyelim. Şimdi arkadaşlar, siz Arena modeli kurduğunuzda sadece bir replication'ın sonucunda kalmazsınız. Sonuçta her şey rastsal olduğuna göre birden çok runlar almamız gerekiyor. Birden çok gözlemler almamız gerekiyor. Siz bir data toplama gibi düşünün bunu. Simülasyonu data toplama gibi. Sonuçta bir sürü gözlem almamız, daha doğru sonuçlar almamız neydi? Replication bu. Replication dediğimiz ya da repetition. Modelinizi birden çok kez run ediyoruz ve ilgilendiğimiz Y2 değişkenine bakıyoruz. Anlaşıldı mı? İlgilendiğimiz, bakın Y2 burada. Bizim ilgilendiğimiz değişken bu. İlk run'da Arena'da göstereceğim bunu bu sırada. Arena'da nerede replication sayısını belirleriz? Bunu nerede belirliyoruz? Bunlar bizim ikinci kısım, final konularımız. Final sınavı. Number of replication, çıktı analizi. İstatistiğe giriyoruz artık arkadaşlar. Bol bol data, veri analizi yapacağız. İstatistiksel analizler yapacağız bayağı. Mesela burada 6 tane run almış. Ve her bir run'dan mesela birinci run'dan elde ettiğim ortalama delay 2,79 dakika. Tamam mı? İkinci run'da 1,12 dakika. Neden değişti bu gözlem? İkinci run'da. Çünkü random sayılar değişti. Simülasyon random sayılarla biliyorsunuz gerçekleşiyor. Değişince random sayılar sonuç değişti. Evet, sonra burada 6 tane gözlemin ortalaması 2,51 dakika ve standart sapması 0,82 dakika. Bunlar nasıl hesaplanıyor sizce? 0,82. Standart sapmayı nasıl hesaplıyoruz? Nasıl hesaplanır? Nasıl hesaplıyoruz arkadaşlar? Standart sapmayı bildiğiniz Excel'de n tane noktanın standart sapması. X eksi x bar kare bölü n eksi birlerin. Hatırlayın, standart sapma. Şu 6 tane nokta var ya, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 tane datanın standart sapması bu. Bu da ortalaması, mean, x bar. Bu da S'i, standart sapması. Şimdi hipotezimiz şu. Validation'da hipotez yapacağız. Şimdi null hipotez diyeceğiz ki, bu Y2'nin ortalama bekleme süresinin, gözlemlediğim popülasyonun gerçek ortalaması 4,3'tür. Sen burada onu görmedin. 2,51 gördüm. Fakat bu datanın gerçek mean'i 4,3 dakikadır. Alternatifte diyecek ki hayır değildir. Dolayısıyla siz bunu, bu testi kabul ederseniz modelinizi kabul ediyorsunuz. Reject ederseniz modelinizi reject ediyorsunuz. Çünkü hatırlayın, gerçek veri 4,3 dakikaydı. Gerçek sistem ortalaması 4,3 dakikaydı. Biz şimdi simülasyondan aynı sonucu alıyor muyuz, alamıyor muyuz? Soru bu. Bu sayılara göre 4,3 kabul edilebilir bir ortalamadır. Ortalamadır mı? Testimiz bu. Hipotez testimiz bu. Anlaşıldı mı? Şimdi hipotez testini nasıl yapacağınızı size göstereceğim. Bunu göstermemiştim. Burada kalmıştık tam olarak. Ve buradan size İngilizce devam edelim arkadaşlar. Şimdi tam kaldığımız yer burasıydı çünkü. Evet, şimdi so how are you going to test this hypothesis? So how are you going to test this hypothesis that expected values of y are 4,3. This population mean is 4,3. So you need to use t test. We need to conduct t test. Why not z-test? Why is it not a z-test instead of it's a t-test? Anybody know the difference between z-test and t-test? Why do we use a t-test here? Usually to test hypothesis, we always use z values. But now we are going to use t values and we call it t-test. We are going to calculate, as in all the tests, we are going to calculate a t statistics, t calculated, and then we are going to get another t value from the table, and we are going to compare them. Is it big or small? And we are going to say accept or reject, just like in z-test. Z calculated, z from the table, and compare. In t-test, it is the same thing. We just calculate a t value, another t value from the table, and see if it is too big or too small. Okay? So, the t value that you calculate is given here. Okay? It is just like the z. Okay? T value is the mean of the data minus the claim divided by, so, s over square root of n. This is just like the z that you calculate. And the calculated t value is 524. T value from the table is 2.571, which means that the difference is unacceptable. Okay, look at this. What you are measuring here is difference. Difference between the simulation minus real data. And if this number is bigger than the critical value, you reject. Reject H0. So we reject H0. Means that the model is not valid. Okay. Now, T is a little bit different. T critical is a little bit different than Z. What is the difference? The difference is this, degrees of freedom. So when you use T table, you need an alpha and you need a degrees of freedom. What do you think is degrees of freedom in this example? Does anybody remember t-test? What is the degrees of freedom in our example? What is degrees of freedom? Degrees of freedom here is number of samples minus one. How many samples we have in this question? Look at this. Number of samples we have is, we have here is six. So n is equal to six. We have six observations. So degrees of freedom will be n minus one. It will be five. Okay. So number of replications minus one will be degrees of freedom in the t-test. So let's clear this. Okay. So this hypothesis is rejected, and then what they, it is not valid, so they change the model, they do the test again, now it is verified. They change the model, they change the code, now in the second trial, it is valid model. Okay, when you are doing a test, there are two values, this is important, this will be in your project, but in the second part, not in the first one. In the second part, when you do output analysis, you are going to talk about alpha and beta. Okay, who knows what is alpha, what is beta? Who can describe them to me? Does anybody knows what is alpha, what is beta? So do you know in hypothesis testing, what are they? So they are called type one error, alpha, and beta is called type two error, right? What is the difference? What was the difference? Do you remember between alpha and beta error? Both of them are errors. Both of them are bad. You don't want to make an error. What kind of error can you make in an hypothesis testing? What is an error? You can make two errors. Your model is wrong and you accept it, or your model is correct. You have a valid model, but then test says reject. There are two things you can do. Which one is alpha, which one is beta? Who can tell me? Okay, let me ask it this way. Rejecting a good model. Which one is this? Rejecting a good model. Yes, this is alpha, right? This is called type 1 error. This is alpha. Rejecting a good model is alpha. And alpha, you can control it by just say it. Alpha should be 0.05. In simulation class, we control it by specifying its value. We say, let alpha be 5%. So we can control alpha. But what about beta? We never talk about beta. So first of all, beta is accepting a bad model. Okay, accepting a bad model. Which one is worse, do you think? Alpha or beta? If you are an engineer, which one is bad for you? Alpha is bad or beta is worse? Which one is worse?
Beta.
Yes, beta is worse because you will make decisions, investments, and you will make your decisions based on a bad model. And it will this. So we never say in hypothesis testing, let beta be this. We never say it, right? We always give alpha. What about beta? Where can we find it? What is our beta level? Maybe we are making a lot of mistakes. Maybe beta is too big, right? You need to control beta as well in any hypothesis test. And the only way to control beta is by sample size, which is number of replications. So number of replications. So how many times you run your model changes the value of beta, okay? So number of replications is the only way. So you need to choose a good number of replications so that your beta is small, acceptable. You want a small beta, okay? So beta should be small. If you just change alpha, if you decrease alpha, beta will increase. If you want to decrease both of them, you need to change sample size. Okay. So for those who took quality control, they know these topics very well. They should know because these are the things we did. So alpha and beta is everything. Remember in quality control, and you will learn these better if you didn't take quality control. You will learn about alpha and beta much more. Now, there is something in simulation. It is called power of the test. And it is equal to 1 minus beta. As you can see, it is 1 minus mistake. So it is the probability that you will not make a mistake. Okay? 1 minus making a mistake is called power. How powerful is your test? So obviously, you want the power to be large. Beta small means power is large, right? So, but what is beta? Again, same question. How do you know? How can I know what is my beta in a given problem? Is it small? Is it large? How can I read it? Where can I read it? In that case, you need to, for people from quality control, they can calculate it, right? They should be able to calculate it. But for now, we are going to use tables. Just tables to... This is the OC curve, quality people. If you remember, operating characteristic curve. You draw this in the class. In the class, we did operating characteristic curve. And if you remember, let me remind you, this is the graph. It gives you beta, okay, versus some number, critical value. It's called critical value. Okay, it's called critical value. So beta versus, so this is the OS curves that you are going to use to find your beta in any given situation. Okay, and this is for alpha 5%. For every alpha, there is OC curve given for every alpha. Now, how to use this is our objective today. How to use this curve is today's objective. Okay. First of all, to make a beta error, remember, when do you make a beta error? Beta error depends on, okay, so remember, beta is accepting a bad model, right? A bad model. Bad model. Okay, so to find beta, you need to tell me how bad is it? how bad? Is it too bad? Or so the, you should give me the how bad is the model? How bad is it? It is to find beta. You need to tell me the problem. So how bad a model is should be given to calculate beta. And it is measured by this number, critical value. Look at the critical value. What does it say? It is the difference between your model expected y minus the system mu divided by sigma. So it's a measure of if the critical value is large. So it is. It means that you the expected value y is much more different than the mu, which is the system, which is the what it should be. Now for quality people, remember to calculate beta, I needed to give you from system shifts from mu zero to mu one. Do you remember those people who took quality? I need to give you the shift size, right? This is the same thing. I need to provide you what is the shift size? How much shift are we talking about? To calculate beta, you need to know this critical value, okay? Now I will give you an example. I will do an example. So in this example, suppose the modeler, which modeler? This is the continuation of this one, this continuation of this model, this example that we did where number of replication is 6, alpha is 5%. At alpha 5%, we accept this model. At alpha 5%, we accepted this model. But we want to know what is our beta. Okay, alpha 5%, but is this my beta is good? Is it small? Now I am interested in finding beta in this question. So the modeler want to reject the model. The modeler would like to reject the model with at least 90% probability. If the mean delay of the model differed from the average delay of the system by 1 minute. What do you understand from this sentence? What does this tell you? Okay, what does this tell you? Okay, so if there is a difference of more than 1 minute between my system and the real system, I want to reject it. 1 minute is important for me. 1 minute difference is critical. And I want to reject it with 90% probability if there is a difference of at least 1 minute. So the problem is giving you this number. Expected y minus the mean of the system should be 1 minute. So this one, the system is giving you this number, 1 minute, okay? And what is this S? This is the standard error from the table. Let me show you. Standard error is 1.66. And the question is, these questions are always like this in simulation. The question always gives you this difference, critical difference. It's called critical difference between the system and real life. And the difference, the modeler wants it to be no more than 1 minute. So the critical value will be 1 minute divided by standard error, which is 0.6. Now we can find our beta error before we solve the questions. Let's go look, remember, our critical difference is 0.6, right? So let's look at the table. So this is the, remember, this is the critical difference. This is the beta. Okay, and 0.6 is here. Okay, and this end shows the number of replications. Currently, how much replications do I have? 6. So which curve should I use? Not this one. This is 5, curve 5. This is curve 7. So it is in between, something like this. The OC curve for n equal to 6 should be something like this. So it means that for critical value 0.6, my beta error is 0.75. Okay, corresponding to of critical value of 0.6. Now, is this acceptable? Beta equals to 0.75. Which?
No.
Yes, this is a very big number, right? The modeler, what does the modeler want? Modeler want that the power of the test to be 90%, at least 90%. The modeler, this is the power, 90%. If the difference is this much, the test should tell you, find the reject the model with 90% probability. This is power. If you want the power to be 90%, the beta should be obviously, remember 1 minus beta should be bigger than 90%, the power. So beta should be less than or equal to 10%, right? So let's go to the table. So beta less than 10% means that, remember, my delta, my critical value is still 0.6. So what I am looking for is something less than 10%. So where is this intersection? Which curve? I think if I increase my number of replications to 30, I will intersect this, right? So it means that I need to increase my number of replications to 30 to make a beta error that is less than 10%. Do you understand how to read this curve? Is it clear? Okay. So n 30 runs. So if you increase n, you will have a lower beta error. You need more replications. Currently, your beta is 0.75, which is very high. Which is very high for this critical value, for this difference, 1 minute difference. Okay. So one last topic for today. Okay. So hypothesis testing is one way to check if your model is valid or not. Okay. Expected value of your. So this was hypothesis testing. Another way you can do is called confidence interval testing. Confidence interval testing. So how does it work? Let me tell you. First of all, do you remember what is confidence interval? Anybody remembers? Does anybody? What was confidence interval? We say 95% confidence interval for some variable. What was this? Do you remember? 95% confidence interval. Confidence interval, as the name gives implies, it gives you confidence. Okay. Now this 4.78 is just called, it is called point estimate. It is just one number. So you are telling me that average waiting time is 4.78 minutes. This is just one number, right? How confident are you? So if I go to the system, am I going to wait this much? Are you confident? Okay. So to answer this question, you give 95% confidence as an interval. So what does it mean? Instead of giving this number, you give an interval. Let's say two, I'm just, it is not correct confidence interval. 2 to 6. So the confidence interval 2 to 6 for the mean waiting time. So what are you saying is that now I am 95% sure that you will wait at least 2 minutes, but no more than 6 minutes. Now you are giving me more information, right? Instead of giving a point estimate, you are giving me an interval. This is called confidence interval. Now, do you remember? Have you seen this before? Have you seen confidence interval before? Anybody?
Yes.
Yes, you have seen, right? You should have seen. So for any statistics, this one number is known as point estimate. It is 1 point. This is known as confidence interval. Which one would you prefer? Which one would you prefer? By the way, the mean, the middle is should be 4.78. The middle is equal to the point estimate. This is not like this in my example because I made up the numbers, but the middle of the confidence interval is always your guess, your point estimate. And then you go sum here and you go some here same length, length h to the up, length h to the left, you get yourself an interval. This is 95% confidence interval. Okay, why I, so this is important for us to understand confidence interval. What is it is meaning? It is important for us because remember, second part of this class is just statistical analysis, analyzing the data from simulation output. After this chapter, we assume that we have a valid model, verified and validated model. Next step will be analyzing the output analysis section. How to use simulation to make decisions. Okay, so another way you can test if your model is valid is using confidence interval. What you do is this. So this is the formula for confidence intervals, if you remember. The mean plus minus t value times s divided by square root of n. This is confidence interval formula. Okay, so it gives you an interval like this. It gives you an interval like this. Okay. And then what you do is this. There are two cases. Let's say you calculated this interval and you want to test whether your model is valid or not. And you know that from the real system, mu zero is 4.3 minutes, right? From the real system, mu zero is 4.3 minutes. Now, what you do is this. This interval, there are two cases, case one, case two. My interval, does it contain mu zero? Is it contain means, is the mu zero inside the interval or is it outside? Okay, so let me show you. Let me clear everything. It's very complicated. Okay, now, I mean, there are a lot of drawings. So the case one, suppose confidence interval doesn't contain mu zero. So this is your confidence interval. And this is the mu zero from the system. Mu zero, which is in our example, 4.3. You do this first. Best case error, worst case error. What is best case and what is worst case error? Look, this mu zero, and this is your waiting time, right? Best case error is this. The difference between real life and your lowest possible value. This is called best case difference. Best case. Worst case difference is this, from here to here. This is the worst case difference. And look, if the best case error is bigger than 1 minute, so epsilon in our example was 1 minute. If it is bigger than 1 minute, model needs to be refined. Now, I mean rejected. Even in the best possible case, difference is more than 1 minute, then it should be rejected. Okay. But if the worst case is less than epsilon, you can accept the model. In the worst case, difference is not even 1 minute, but there is in between. If the best case is less than epsilon, then you need more replications. Okay. And now you look at the second scenario. In this scenario, the confidence interval contains the mu zero. Again, best case error is zero because you can choose this point, right? Best case error is zero. And worst case error, what is worst case error in this case? What is the worst case error? What is the worst possible difference between your model and real life? So this is the from your model and this is the real system. Worst case difference is this much, right? Biggest possible difference. Okay. And if it is more than epsilon, you need more replications, additional replications. If it is less than epsilon, you accept the model. Okay. So that is how you conduct. Let me show you an example here. Mu zero was 4.3, epsilon was 1 minute in our example. 95% confidence interval for our problem is this, 165, 3.33 minutes. Now is it inside or outside the mean, real mean? Inside interval or outside?
Outside.
So it is outside, right? 4.3 minutes is outside. So base case difference is 4.3 minus this 3.37. And worst case difference is 4.3 minus lower end 1.65. So look at the numbers. Base case less than one, but worst case bigger than one, which means that we are not sure. I am not sure whether to accept or reject. I am undecided, which means that please do more replications so that I can make a decision. Okay. So what happens if you make more replications? Look at the effect. If you increase this, what will happen? If you increase n, what will happen? For any confidence interval, if you make more replications, what does it mean for the confidence interval? Does it become smaller or larger?
Smaller.
Yes, it becomes smaller, right? You are so as you increase n more replications, you are more certain of your outcome. Okay, so more additional replications mean in every case I cannot decide. Please do more replications so that I can decide. Okay, if you see additional replications, it means we are not sure. I am not sure. Okay, so the only way we reject is here. This is the only way case where we reject. Okay, in which case confidence interval doesn't contain mu zero and even the best case error is more than epsilon, then definitely reject. Okay. I am going to skip this. It is a little bit early. We are going to see this concept of comparing common random numbers using common random numbers. What does it mean is that? So let's say in real life, at 8 o'clock, a customer come to your restaurant. In simulation, you do the same. At 8 o'clock, you send the customer. In real life, let's say 8:10, another customer arrived. In your simulation, you do the same. 8:10, you send another customer. And this is, in this case, comparison is a little bit different. And we will talk about this later when we are talking about output analysis. It is called inducing correlation, common random numbers between these two things. And last slide for today. Turing test is another thing. Turing test. You know what is Turing test? Anybody remembers Turing test? Turing, you know, try to test whether computers are intelligent or not, right? To test if you have a computer which you claim that it has artificial intelligence and it is like human, you can do it Turing's test to see whether it is really human or not. So they present the system, 10 system performances to a manager. 5 of them are real, 5 of them are from your simulation. And if the person cannot differentiate the answers, fake reports, then you have an idea that they are valid. Okay, so this is like testing a computer for intelligence. You can search for Turing tests. They are Alan Turing, and he did these kind of tests. And we are using the same idea. Okay, so that's it for today. Do you have any questions for today? Okay, good luck tomorrow in your midterm exam. Okay, it is at 6:30. 6:30'da değil mi arkadaşlar? 6:30'da.
Evet.
Tamam. O zaman sınavınızda başarılar. Sorunuz yoksa bugünlük bu kadar.
Teşekkürler hocam.
Oldu, iyi günler.
İyi günler hocam.
İyi günler hocam.